Studio setups are commonplace in Blender projects such as product visualization, and of course, renders and animation. Today, we'll get our scene set up, ready for animation in the next lesson. First of all, I'm going to hide some of the objects I don't need here. So I'm just going to left click my torus here, and up here in the top right hand corner, you can see there's an eye and a camera button. The eye button will remove it in the 3D viewport, and the camera button will remove it in render. So it's important to press both of these. If you can't see these buttons, left click this filter button here, and you can see you can enable it here. I'll also do the same for my component. Next up, I'm going to press Shift A, and then under mesh, I'm going to left click plane. Then I'm going to zoom into my plane here, press Tab to go into Edit Mode, and 2 to go into Edge Select Mode. Then I'll left click this edge here, and I'm going to press E and Z, and just pull this up. Now, if we want to make this a bit more smooth, we can left click our edge here, and press Control B, and this will create a smooth transition between the two. We can left click it, and then you can also open this menu here to increase the segments. You can also use your mouse wheel to do this. Once I've done that, I'll right click and choose Shade Auto Smooth. I'm going to press S, and that will enable the scale mode. I'm going to make it a bit bigger, so it's a bit more appropriate compared to the size of my tessellation. I'll maybe move it to around there. I'll then left click my swirl shape here, and press G and Y, G for grab, and Y to move it along the Y axis. The Y axis is this green line here, as indicated by the symbol up here. I'll then press Shift D, and this is going to duplicate my swirl. The reason I'm doing this is because in my animation, I have two of these. I'll then press R, which will enable rotation mode. And now if I move my mouse, you can see it rotates along with it. But what I'm going to do is press R, Y, which will then rotate it on only the Y axis, and then you can type in a number to move it a certain degrees. If we type in the number 90, that will move it 90 degrees, like this. Then I can press G and Y to move it along. You can then shift left click these two, and move them more towards the middle. I'm also going to left click my studio background here, and press G and Z to pull it down a little bit. And now I have my two objects floating in front of our studio. Next up, we're going to add the camera. So I'm going to press Shift A, and in the add menu, there's an option called camera. You may have a camera in your scene by default, in which case, you can just use that camera. I'll select my camera by left clicking it here in the outlier, or in the 3D viewport if you can find it, and press G and X to pull it along this X axis. So I'm grabbing it with G, and then moving it along the X axis with X. If you want to see what your camera is looking at, and what your render will look like, you can left click this film camera button here. You can also press numpad 0 if you have a numpad. Now we're in the camera view, we want to figure out how to get the camera to move when we move in Blender, as this will be much quicker than moving it manually. So I'll press N to open the side menu, and I'm going to come up to view. Under view lock, this may be closed view, I'll left click to open it, and I'm going to choose this lock camera to view option. Now when I move the hand symbol, you can see my camera moves with it. You can also use your middle mouse button to navigate, or if you're on laptop, you can also use this gizmo here in order to move your viewport. I'm going to keep moving my camera into position until I get something I'm happy with. You can also left click your camera and press R and Y, for example, rotate it up and down, and you can do that for all the axes. For example, R and Z to move it left and right, and R and X move it this way. Although I don't want to go for this kind of dynamic angle. I'll maybe move it up a little bit with the hand icon, and press R and Y to rotate it down a tiny bit. I can also press G and Z to grab it and pull it up. This should do for now, because we're going to create an empty in the next episode in order to control our camera much easier. If you want to come out of this camera mode, you can left click this film camera, and you can see it is in position. Now, we need to make everything a bit more of an appropriate scale. When we add the lighting, it will be a little bit easier to understand and follow along. And also, if you want to use depth of field in your render or animation, it is important everything is at the correct scale. In order to see what scale things are at, we need to left click this item tab in the side menu. You can then left click this transform panel to see everything here. If I left click my 3D swirl here, you can see there's this thing called dimensions. This tells me what the real world scale of this object is. And right now you can see it's almost 3 meters tall. I'm going to press A to select everything, and then I'm going to shift left click one of the swirls last. The reason I do that, we can see the dimensions of the last selected object, as I'm going to use that as my reference point. Then I'll press S to scale everything down. It's also important to remember that this button here isn't on individual origins, and rather is set to medium point. That'll scale everything equally, rather than individually. I'll then press S, and I'm going to scale it down until our X and Y are around 0.7, which is around 70 centimeters. About there should do nicely. Now, if I want to go back, I can just zoom in. Now, I'm going to press the film camera button to go back into my camera view. And if I left click my camera in the outliner here, you can see we have a bunch of settings. The first thing is focal length. This is a real world camera feature, and in different types of photography, you tend to use a different focal length. For example, if I was doing a character render, I would probably use a focal length around 100. But for this project, I'm going to keep it at a focal length at 50. Anything lower than this may look a little skewed, so do be careful when using this focal length parameter. Here's what it looks like when you adjust this value. In film and animation, performing a zoom is done by changing the focal length. I'm going to change this back to 50. Under viewport display, we're going to have a bunch more settings here. This past part out, if I turn this up to 1, We'll make it so we can only see what is on our camera. This can be handy to make things clear. I've also got these composition guides here, which will allow me to better compose my image. For example, if you're aware of the rule of thirds and you want to use it for your render or animation, you can turn on this to see the points on the image where there's a third. There's also a center option, which will allow us to make things nice in the middle. And you even have settings for a golden ratio if you want to use that. Then we also have depth of field, which will allow us to make some things in focus and other things not so much. We're not going to be using this in this project, so we're not going to focus on this for this course. If you're wanting to learn how to add the lighting to the studio, you can check out the video in the top right hand corner now. Keep in mind, if you're watching this video while it airs, this video will be out in 2 days time. For everyone else though, we're going to be moving on to animation in the next episode before we cover lighting. But first, we're going to have a quick quiz. Number 1, how did we create the studio background? Number 2, how did we move our camera more easily? Number 3, why did we scale everything to a more realistic scale? Feel free to pause the video and take time to answer the questions. And then when you're ready, you can just press play and listen to my answers. Number 1. How did we create the studio background? To do this, we just created the plane, then we pressed E for extrude on the edge at the end in order to pull up another face. Then, in order to make the transition smooth, we first beveled it by pressing Ctrl B, which creates that smooth transition on an edge, and then we went into object mode and pressed right click shade smooth. This allowed us to get rid of the jaggedness on the bevel. Number 2. How did we move our camera more easily? To do this, we left click this film camera button, and then once we were in camera view, we pressed N to open the side menu, went up to the view panel, and under view lock, we turned on camera to view. This meant when we moved the hand icon or the zoom icon or done any other type of movement in the 3D viewport, the camera would move with us. Number 3. Why did we scale everything to a more realistic scale? This is more of a general guideline in order to allow us to have better depth of field, as well as making things easier to work with in projects in general. It will also help you follow along with this course more easier once I get into lighting in 2 episodes time. If you're unsure if you answered the questions correctly or not, feel free to type your answers in the comment section below and I'll answer them for you. Also, if you have any other questions about today's video, please feel free to ask. Apart from that though, tomorrow we're going to be moving on to animation. Also, if you enjoy my teaching style, I also provide one-on-one coaching, complete with personalized lessons and post-lesson quiz questions and support. Link in the description if you're interested. Thank you for making it to the end of the video. You can also support the channel by making a one-time donation through Super, but even just liking, subscribing and sharing if you enjoyed is more than enough to support the channel. Thank you again for watching and I'll see you in the next video. Take care.